أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم، واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى قيام يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة، وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا، حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. In our last lesson, we shed light on the part of the verses that speak about the change of the Qibla, specifically when Allah says, قُلْ لِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبُ. And we mentioned two important points that we derive from that segment. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He says, قُلْ لِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبُ, He is telling us that ultimately the East and the West belong to Him. Hence, He is the one who decides which direction will be our Qibla when we pray. He has full authority to tell us to face the east or the west or the north or the south or any other direction, and to take that direction as our Qibla when we are performing Salat. Secondly, the second point that we derive from that important segment is that Allah Azza wa Jalla is reminding us that the East and the West belong to Him, and so we are demanded to obey Him subhanahu wa ta'ala wherever we may be. Even if we live in a non-Islamic country or a non-Islamic province or city, that does not give us the excuse of disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wherever someone may be, he needs to obey his Lord Jalla Jalaluhu. Then we read a tradition by Imam Al-Hasan Al-Askari, Abu Muhammad salawatullah wa salamuhu alayh, found in the book Al-Ihtijaj, in which the Imam mentions what happened after migration and what happened before the change of the Qibla, what led to the change of the Qibla. So we mentioned how the Jews, certain rebels amongst the Jews, were ridiculing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. They were mocking him, and the Prophet was disturbed from their mocking. And it got to a point where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wanted, he desired that the Qibla be changed. He desired that Allah Ta'ala changes the Qibla. Of course, Rasulullah is completely submissive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so he continued to pray towards Bayt al-Maqdis, which was the initial Qibla, even though the Jews were ridiculing him, even though they were mocking him. But their mocking was quite disturbing, and it was also quite dangerous, because the words they were saying about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam were a direct attack at the Prophet's prophethood, at his nubuwa sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after the Prophet supplicated and asked Allah jalla jalalu to change the Qibla, Allah Jalla Jalaluhu brought down a verse in the Holy Quran where He tells the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi that from now on, when you want to pray, face al-Masjid al-Haram. From now on, the Qibla will be the sacred mosque. It will be, meaning it will be al-Kaaba, the holy house, the holy Kaaba inside the sacred mosque, al-Masjid al-Haram. Today, inshallah, we're going to continue with the the dialogue between the Jews and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Before the Qibla was changed, they were mocking Rasulullah. And after the Qibla was changed, they began what? Objecting to what the Prophet did sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And there was an important dialogue that happened between the Prophet and these people. So we're going to read, we're going to read what Imam al-Askari sallallahu alayhi said. Again, this tradition is found in the book Al-Ihtijaj for Shaykh al-Tabrasi rahmatullah ta'ala alayhi. So the Imam says, وَجَاءَ قَوْمٌ مِنَ الْيَهُودِ. I sent you the tradition on the chat section. وَجَاءَ قَوْمٌ مِنَ الْيَهُودِ إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ. A group of Jews came to the Prophet. فَقَالُوا يَا مُحَمَّدِ هَذِهِ الْقِبْلَةُ بَيْتُ الْمَقْدِسِ قَدْ صَلَّيْتَ إِلَيْهَا 14 سَنَةً ثُمَّ تَرَكْتَهَا الْآنِ أَفَحَقًّا كَانَ مَا كُنْتَ عَلَيْهِ فَقَدْ تَرَكْتَهُ إِلَى بَاطِلٍ فَإِنَّمَا يُخَالِفُ الْحَقَّ بَاطِلٍ. So they said, O Muhammad, you used to pray towards Bayt al-Maqdis, and you prayed towards Bayt al-Maqdis, you would face it in prayer during 14 years, throughout 14 years. And now you've changed the Qibla, you're facing a different Qibla. So tell us, when you were facing Bayt al-Maqdis, was that deed part of truth? As in, was it part of the message of truth? If it was part of the message of truth, since you have changed the Qibla and you're facing Al-Masjid al-Haram, then that means right now your deed is part of falsehood. It's batil, it's not haqq, it's part of falsehood. So you've deviated, in other words, Ya Muhammad. Because anything that contradicts the truth is what? A form of falsehood. Anything that contradicts haqq is batil, it's a form of batil. Then they said, أو باطلا كان ذلك فقد كنت عليه طول هذه المدة فما يؤمننا أن تكون الآن على باطل. They told him, however, if you say that when you were facing Bayt al-Maqdis, that deed was part of falsehood, it was not part of the message of truth, since you followed that deed, you implemented that deed, which was part of falsehood, for all of this time, for about 14 years, you were praying towards Bayt al-Maqdis. So what tells us now that when you're facing Masjid al-Haram, Al-Masjid al-Haram, that this deed is actually part of truth? Which is a valid point if you think about it. I'm not saying that they're right, obviously they're wrong, but the mentality, the way they're thinking, the idea itself is correct, but the application is wrong. They're applying the idea at the wrong time and in the wrong place and to the wrong person. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not commit any deeds that are part of falsehood. He does not commit any deeds that displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nor does he hold any false beliefs. But the idea itself that they're presenting in itself is correct. What does it say? They're saying if you were following batil, if you were following falsehood all of this time, then what tells us that right now you are what? Following the truth. And that's what we say when it comes to infallibility. If the Prophets alayhim as-salatu was-salam, at a certain point, you know, they commit sins, they follow what is wrong, they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they commit major or minor sins, then what tells us that later on they're not doing the same? So this idea actually confirms what? Confirms and supports the infallibility of the Prophets alayhim as-salatu was-salam. So this was their question to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. How did the Prophet answer? فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ بَلْ ذَلِكَ كَانَ حَقًّا وَهَذَا حَقٌّ. He told them that you are what? You've made a mistake. You are making a mistake. When I was praying towards Bayt al-Maqdis, that was haqq. It was part of truth. It was part of the message of truth. And now, when I pray towards Al-Masjid al-Haram, that's also haqq. It's also part of the message of truth. Why? How come he's saying this, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? Well, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directed a command at Rasulullah, which was a temporary command. It was a mansukh. It became a mansukh law. And that was to face Bayt al-Maqdis. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changed the command. He directed a new command at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And this command became what? A nasikh law. It was a permanent law. Allah ta'ala has the authority to do what he wants. يَفْعَلُ مَا يَشَاءُ. And so if he wants to replace one hukm with another, he wants to change one hukm with another, he wants to change his laws, he has full authority to do so. جَلَّ جَلَالُهُ. So he tells them, بَلْ ذَلِكَ كَانَ حَقًّا وَهَذَا حَقٌّ. Both are what? Part of truth. Both are part of truth. During the 14 years, our duty was to pray towards Bayt al-Maqdis. And now, and up until the day of judgment, our duty will be to pray towards Al-Kaaba. يَقُولُ اللَّهُ. The Prophet continues, يقول الله قل لله المشرق والمغرب يهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم. Say, he tells them, Allah says, say, to Allah only belong the east and the west. He guides whom he wills to a straight path. إذا عرف صلاحكم أيها العباد فَاسْتِقْبَالِكُمُ الْمَشْرِقِ أَمَرَكُمْ بِهِ وَإِذَا عَرَفَ صَلَاحَكُمْ فَاسْتِقْبَالِ الْمَغْرِبِ أَمَرَكُمْ بِهِ. He says, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that your well-being, O slaves of God, lies in facing the east when you are in prayer, meaning taking the east as your qibla, then Allah Ta'ala will command you to face the east when you are what? Praying. And if he knows that your well-being lies in facing the west when you are praying, then he will command you to face the west. He will command you to take the west as what? As your qibla. Now, why does he mention the east and the west here? Aside of these two being two main directions in our world, it's also possible because it is said that the Christians, their qibla was the east, and the Jews, their qibla was the west. And so, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continues, and he says, وَإِنْ عَرَفَ صَلَاحَكُمْ فِي غَيْرِهِمَا أَمَرَكُمْ بِهِ. And if he knows, if Allah knows that your well-being lies in facing a different direction, a direction different than the east and the west, then he will command you to do so. He will command you to take that direction as your qibla. So the Prophet is reminding them and us, sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sallam, that ultimately the laws of God revolve around what? Our well-being. Revolve around what benefits us and what protects us from harm. Allah wants to lead us to benefit and to protect us from harm. So he says, فَلَا تُنْكِرُوا تَدْبِيرَ اللَّهِ فِي عِبَادِهِ وَقَصْدَهُ إِلَى مَصَالِحِكُمْ. فَلَا تُنْكِرُوا تَدْبِيرَ اللَّهِ فِي عِبَادِهِ وَقَصْدَهُ إِلَى مَصَالِحِكُمْ. So he says, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, do not find the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses to manage your affairs to be bizarre. Don't find that bizarre. Allah is all wise, and even though you might find certain actions that stem from Allah Azza wa Jal to be bizarre, in reality they are correct actions and they are the best actions. Allah always takes the best decisions. Jalla Jalaluhu. And He does what needs to be done. He does what leads his creations to benefit subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when He manages our affairs, Jalla Jalalu, Allah Azza wa Jal sometimes will decree something that we might not understand. Why did Allah decree this specific law or this specific incident? We might not understand it. But if we remember that He is the all-wise, Jalla Jalalu, and the all-knowledgeable, and we also remember His other traits, such as that He's all-kind, all-generous, all-merciful, all-just, then we will know that we need to submit to what He chooses, Jalla Jalalu, and that whatever He chooses is best. Whatever He chooses is best. We, Shia Imamiyya, believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never commit an evil deed. All of His deeds are good. And He will never abandon a good deed. He will never abandon it unless there's something better to be done. So what we mean to say is, if Allah ta'ala does something, for example, He creates a particular creation, or He sustains a particular creation with some form of sustenance, or He lets a particular event happen, so on and so forth, Allah Azza wa Jal will never do something evil. Evil does not come from God. Everything that comes from God is good. And Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha confirmed or reconfirmed this concept when she said, "Ma ra'aytu illa jamila." I did not see anything but beauty. When asked, of course, how did you find Allah's treatment towards your household? Salawatullah wa salamu alayhim. So, everything that stems from Allah is good. Allah Azza wa Jal will not abandon a good deed unless what? There's something better to be done. Or there's something that's best. Better than that specific deed. So the narration continues here. And the Imam says, عليه الصلاة والسلام, فَقَالُوا لَهُ يَا مُحَمَّدُ أَفَبَدَى لِرَبِّكَ فِي مَا كَانَ أَمَرَكَ بِهِ بِزَعْمِكَ مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ إِلَى بَيْتِ الْمَقْدِسِ حَتَّى نَقَلَكَ إِلَى الْكَعْبَةِ. They told him, O Muhammad, you used to pray towards Bayt al-Maqdis, and now you're praying towards Al-Kaaba. You're saying Allah Ta'ala told you to do so. Allah commanded you to change the Qibla. Tell us, is this a result of Bida'? Did your Lord go through Bida'? Or what some people like to call Bada'? Did Allah go through Bida' or Bada'? And for that reason, He changed the law? Realize, when you're reading this tradition, you can see how stubborn these people were. They were really stubborn. And so the dialogue was quite long. It was quite lengthy between them and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. But Rasulullah continuously presented the right answers that would silence them, that would not give them the chance to refute what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi was saying. So here they're telling him, did your Lord go through bida' or bada'? What does that mean? What does that mean? Here, the bida' or bada' they're referring to is what we call bida' nadama or bida' jahlin. Let me simplify my words for you. What they mean to say is, since your Lord, O Muhammad, changed the law based on your claims, then did he change the law out of ignorance and out of regret? As in, is it that he was ignorant of the fact that you had to pray towards al-Kaaba? And because of his ignorance, he told you to pray towards Bayt al-Maqdis. But then he found out, he found out what he did not know previously. He gained knowledge. And because he gained knowledge, he regretted telling you to face Bayt al-Maqdis. And now he told you to face al-Kaaba. Is this what happened to your Lord? Now, I think it's quite obvious that Rasulullah is going to say no. Allah Ta'ala is all-knowledgeable. He's omniscient. He knows everything before it happens. Jalla Jalalu. And he does not regret any deed. He is the all-wise. So what will the Prophet say? As in, what will he say in detail? Let us listen to the Prophet's answer. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ مَا بَدَى لَهُ عَنْ ذَلِكَ فَإِنَّهُ الْعَالِمُ بِالْعَوَاقِبِ. He told them, Allah did not go through that kind of bid'ah. Allah Azza wa Jal did not change the law regarding the Qibla out of ignorance, because he was ignorant and now he became knowledgeable, or he gained knowledge. It's not that Allah regretted what he had done, for he is the one who is what? Al-alimu bil-awaqib. He is the one who knows the consequences and the results of the actions that are done, whether those actions stem from Allah Ta'ala or they stem from his creations. Of course, keep in mind that when we say actions stem from Allah, we mean that he creates. Jalla Jalalu. He creates a particular being. His creation of a particular being, or his creation of a particular, say, event or era, so on and so forth, that is what the action of God. Jalla Jalalu. So he knows the results and the consequences of what? Of the actions. وَالْقَادِرُ عَلَى الْمَصَالِحِ. And he also, and he is the one who is able to lead his creations towards well-being, towards benefit. لَا يَسْتَدْرِكُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ غَلَطًا. He does not commit a mistake and then come forth to fix the mistake. We do that, right? We're fallible human beings. We fall into mistakes and then we fix those mistakes. Allah Ta'ala is perfect, Jalla Jalaluh. And so he does not commit any mistake for him to come forth and fix it. And in order to confirm this reality, or to remind us of it, Allah creates selected servants, prophets and imams, alayhim as-salatu was-salam, that are what? That are infallible and do not commit mistakes, for them to come forward and fix what they had done. So the prophets and the imams do not even commit mistakes for them to come and fix those mistakes, let alone the creator of those prophets and imams, alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Bear in mind, when we say the imams, Sayyida Zahra is always included, alayha salatu wassalam. Although she was not literally an imam, she was not one of the 12 imams, but she is what? She is the mistress of the women of the world, salawatullahi alayha. And as Imam al-Askari says, she is the proof of Allah over the imams, alayhim as-salatu wassalam, meaning over her own descendants, over her own descendants. وَلَا يَسْتَحْدِثُ رَأْيًا. ولا يستحدث رأيا بخلاف المتقدم جل عن ذلك. The prophet continues to describe Allah. He says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not come up with new opinions. As in, he does not make a particular decision and then change that decision based on what? Based on new information that he gains. So he presents a particular opinion and then he realizes, you know, that opinion was not the best or it was wrong. So he comes forth to do what? To change it. He says Allah Ta'ala is not like that. That happens to us fallible human beings, but it doesn't happen to God. وَلَا يَقَعُ عَلَيْهِ أَيْضًا مَانَعُ يَمْنَعُهُ مِنْ مُرَادِهِ. He says, on top of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He wants something to happen, it happens. When He wants something to happen, nothing can prevent Allah's will from taking place. Here, we remember the name Al-Qahhar and Al-Qahir. These two names, Al-Qahhar and Al-Qahir, remind us of Allah's dominance. That He's not only powerful, He's dominant. Such that when He wants, when He truly wants something to happen, it happens. Khalas. Even if the whole world tries to stop it from happening, it happens. Here we remember Musa salamullah alayhi, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted Musa to come into this world and to live. Although Pharaoh was slaughtering the male children of Banu Israel and was captivating their women, turning their women into maids and she-slaves, Allah Ta'ala decided to take Musa to Pharaoh himself, to the Pharaoni castle, which was the most dangerous place for Musa to be in. But Allah wants to show us, when I want something to happen, it's going to happen. Even if 1,000 pharaohs try to prevent it from happening. Musa comes to the hands of Pharaoh and he stays alive. Allah keeps him alive. He grows, then destroys the Pharaoh and saves Banu Israel. The same applies to who? Sahib al-Zaman, Ajjal Allah Ta'ala Farajahu al-Sharif. Even if the whole world join forces to stop Imam al-Mahdi from his reappearance or to defeat him after his reappearance, they will fail. Why? Simply because Imam al-Mahdi is aided and supported by Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. And Allah Ta'ala will bring victory to Sahib al-Zaman salawatullah alayh, whether people like it or not. So he says, وَلَا يَقَعُ عَلَيْهِ أَيْضًا مَانِعٌ يَمْنَعُهُ مِنْ مُرَادِهِ وَلَيْسَ يَبْدُو إِلَّا لِمَنْ كَانَ هَذَا وَصْفُهُ. Excuse me. He says, صلى الله عليه وآله, that the bid'ah you're mentioning, O Jews, the bid'ah which is a result of ignorance and regret, only befalls a person who doesn't have these traits. Meaning a person or a being that, you know, makes mistakes, a being that goes through ignorance, a being that changes his opinions based on lack of knowledge, a being who's not able to do everything he wants to do. He wills for something to happen, and sometimes it doesn't happen. Such beings, yes, they go through the bid'ah that you're talking about. But Allah Ta'ala is not like that. And so he says, وَهُوَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ يَتَعَالَ عَنْ هَذِهِ الصِّفَاتِ غُلُوًا كَبِيرًا. He says, however, Allah, excuse me, however, Allah Jalla Jalaluh is a greater more majestic. He is greater than to be afflicted with such traits or such states. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Prophet continued, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, let me send you the next part of his word. So he says, ثم قال لهم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله. Imam al-Askari says, عليه السلام, then the Prophet told them, صلى الله عليه وآله, أيها اليهود, أخبروني عن الله, أليس يمرض ثم يصح ويصح ثم يمرض, أبدا له في ذلك. He told them, O Jews, inform me, tell me something about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doesn't Allah afflict people with sickness at times and then he restores their health? And doesn't he give people health and sometimes he afflicts them with sickness? This is the reality of this world. Yes, sometimes you're healthy, sometimes you're not. You're sick. Sometimes you're sick and all of a sudden your health is restored, you become healthy again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees that today fulan will fall sick. Today fulan will not fall sick. Today fulan will be healthy. So, doesn't Allah azza wa jal bestow health and sickness on people at different times? أَبَدَى لَهُ فِي ذَلِكَ. Tell me, is this a result of bid'ah? As in, is this a result of the bid'ah which stems from ignorance and regret? Is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, he's making a mistake when he's giving that person health, so he changes his decision or his decree, and he says, I want to make him sick? And then he says, no, you know what, I made a mistake, so I'm going to restore his health. Is that the case? Obviously, that's not the case. That's not the case. The decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in the hands of God. And as we said, Allah ta'ala takes what? The best decisions. Jalla jalalu. Then he said, أَلَيْسَ يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتُ أَلَيْسَ يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتُ أَبَدَى لَهُ فِي كُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْ ذَلِكَ. He says, doesn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give his creations life? And then he afflicts them with death. Is this a result of bid'ah? Is this a result of bid'ah which stems from ignorance and regret? At times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes, he gives us life, right? A baby is born into this world. He gave it life. And then one day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the soul of that individual who was one day a baby. So he puts that individual through death. He bestows death upon him or her. Is that a result of bid'ah? Obviously not. It's not. It's a result of Allah's hikmah, Allah's wisdom. Allah Azza wa Jal chooses. Now I'm going to give this person life. Now I'm going to bestow death upon him. I'm going to take his soul. And one day Allah Ta'ala will decree to give us life again. At least on the Day of Judgment, if not before the Day of Judgment, meaning the Day of Raj'ah. Because on the Day of Raj'ah, yes, certain individuals will come back to this world. But everyone will come back in their physical forms when? On the Day of Judgment. Although, throughout that time, after their death and before the Day of Judgment, they will be in what? In Barzakh, in Purgatory, they will be in their own they will have their own lives in the world of purgatory. So the Prophet is telling them, look, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes his decree. He says, today this person is going to be healthy. Today that person is going to be sick. Today this person will live. Today that person will die. He's changing his decree. Is that a result of the bid'ah, which stems from ignorance and regret? قالوا لا. They said, no, it's not. قال فكذلك الله تعبد نبيه محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله إلى الكعبة بعد أن تعبده بالصلاة إلى بيت المقدس. He told them the same applies to the law pertaining to the change of the Qibla, or the laws pertaining to the change of the Qibla. Allah commanded his prophet Muhammad. The prophet is talking about himself. He tells them Allah commanded his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, to pray towards the Qibla after he had commanded him to pray towards Bayt al-Maqdis. وَمَا بَدَى لَهُ فِي الْأَوَّلِ. And this was not a result of what? Of bid'ah. Bid'ah, which stems from ignorance and regret. Then the Prophet gave them another example. ثُمَّ قَالْ أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ يَأْتِي بِالشِّتَاءِ فِي أَثَرِ الصَّيْفِ وَالصَّيْفِ فِي أَثَرِ الشِّتَاءِ أَبَدَى لَهُ فِي كُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّن ذَلِكِ. He said, look at the seasons. Doesn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring winter after summer? And then he brings summer after winter. Is this a result of bid'ah? Does he do that because, you know, he realizes, whoops, I made a mistake, so now I have to change the decree? That's not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings winter because there's a need for winter. There are lessons that we need to learn from the winter. And there are benefits that we acquire from the winter. And then he brings the summer, right? He brings the summer. Obviously, summer comes after spring, right? And winter comes after fall. But here the Prophet is, you know, speaking in a general manner, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, and he's saying that winter comes after summer, and summer comes after winter, which is correct without doubt. So, he does that because we need the summer, and we also need the winter. There are benefits that we derive from both, and there are lessons as well that we derive from the winter and the summer. This is an important point to keep in mind. Some people think that, you know, natural phenomena only have natural effects on us, as in the natural phenomena that take place are presented by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so we may gain a physical benefit, which is true, but it's not the whole truth. Allah Azza wa Jal brings these phenomena not only to benefit us from a physical perspective, but also to benefit us from a belief perspective or from a moral perspective. There are lessons pertaining to morals and lessons pertaining to beliefs that we can derive from the seasons, just the seasons, fall, winter, spring and summer. So he says, أَبَدَ لَهُ فِي كُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّن ذَلِكَ. Is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala went through bid'ah, the bid'ah that stems from ignorance and regret, and for that reason he changes the seasons? قَالُوا لَا. They said, no. قَالَ فَكَذَلِكَ لَمْ يَبْدُ لَهُ فِي الْقِبْلَةِ. He said, the same applies to the issue of the Qibla. It was not a result of bid'ah, the bid'ah that we were mentioning. قال ثم قال أليس قد ألزمكم في الشتاء أن تحترزوا من البرد بالثياب الغليظة وألزمكم في الصيف أن تحترزوا من الحر. He told them, during the winter, doesn't Allah Ta'ala obligate you to protect yourselves from the cold using thick clothes? And during the summer, doesn't Allah Ta'ala obligate you to protect yourself from the heat? أَفَبَدَ لَهُ فِي الصَّيْفِ حِينَ أَمَرَكُمْ بِخِلَافِ مَا كَانَ أَمَرَكُمْ بِهِ فِي الشِّتَاءِ. We realize here that the commands of Allah differ. During the winter, there's a specific command, and that is to protect yourself from the cold. And during the summer, there's a command, and that is to protect yourself from the heat. So these two commands, the difference in these commands, is it a result of the bid'ah that we're talking about? قالوا لا. They said no. And so the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, فَكَذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ تَعَبَّدَكُمْ فِي وَقْتٍ لِصَلَاحٍ يَعْلَمُهُ بِشَيْءٍ ثُمَّ تَعَبَّدَكُمْ فِي وَقْتٍ آخَرٍ لِصَلَاحٍ يَعْلَمُهُ بِشَيْءٍ آخَرٍ. He told them the same applies to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you. Sorry. He said the same applies to Allah ta'ala, meaning it applies to Allah in all issues, in all affairs. At a certain time, Allah will direct a particular command at you, because He knows that your well-being, your benefit lies in what? Implementing that command. And at another time, Allah Azza wa Jal will command you to do something else, to do something different, because He knows your well-being and your benefit lies in implementing that command. فَإِذَا أَطَعْتُمُ اللَّهَ فِي الْحَالَتَيْنِ اسْتَحْقَقْتُمْ ثَوَابَهُ. He says, so if you obey Allah in both states, meaning you apply both of God's commands, then you will deserve His reward. فَأَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَلِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبُ فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا فَثَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ. At that point, Allah brought down this specific verse, which we will analyze, inshallah, in the upcoming lessons. The Imam says, يعني إذا توجهتم بأمره فثم الوجه الذي تقصدون منه الله وتأملون ثوابه. He says, meaning, the meaning of this verse is that if you face a particular direction and you take it as the Qibla, as your Qibla, because of Allah's commands, فثم الوجه الذي تقصدون منه الله وتأملون ثوابه, then know that this is the direction, that is the direction which will lead you to getting closer to Allah, which will lead you to having a lofty status in the eyes of Allah, and which will lead you to the rewards of God, Jalla Jalaluhu. So the issue goes back to what? To obeying Allah and submitting to His command, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll conclude with this one statement by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is a very deep statement that needs pondering and helps us a lot when it comes to submitting to Allah's laws and submitting to Allah's decree, His qada and qadar, especially when we're unsure why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does what He does, when we're unsure why Allah Azza wa Jal chooses to make us go through certain phases or calamities or, you know, issues in our lives. A person must trust the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, Ya ibadallah, O slaves of Allah, antum kalmarda, you are like the sick. Meaning you are like a sick patient who's in need of what? Treatment. Wallahu rabbul alameen kattabib. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the worlds, is like the doctor. What's interesting is, one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? The doctor. Specifically, tabibana. We call Him ya tabibana, O our doctor, in dua al-jawshan al-kabir. And we also say, ya tabiba man la tabiba lah, O doctor of he who does not have a doctor. So these two names are mentioned in Dua al-Jawshan al-Kabir, which was given to us by Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhim. So he says Allah Ta'ala is like the doctor, meaning he's the one who will treat you. And he knows exactly what kind of treatment you need. So he says, let me send you the last part of the tradition. فَصَلَاحُ الْمَرْضَى فِي مَا يَعْمَلُهُ الطَّبِيبُ وَيُدَبِّرُهُ بِهِ. He says, the well-being of the sick lies in the treatment of the doctor, in the way the doctor treats his patient, his sick patient. لَا فِي مَا يَشْتَهِيهِ الْمَرِيضُ وَيَقْتَرِحُهُ. It does not lie, his well-being does not lie in what the sick desires and what he proposes. So what the Prophet means to say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that when a sick patient goes to a reliable and trusted doctor, he submits to the treatment of the doctor because he knows that he knows how to treat him. The patient might think that his treatment lies in this specific deed or this specific medicine, but he doesn't know this medicine will increase his sickness. This medicine will harm him even more. Whereas the doctor knows exactly what treatment he needs and what medicine he needs. So a wise man or a wise woman will submit to the doctor. Again, which doctor? The trusted doctor, the reliable doctor. He or she will submit to that doctor's treatment because they know that he knows best. So the same applies to God Jalla Jalaluhu when it comes to al-qada wal-qadr and the laws that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala prescribes upon us. هذا والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على المصطفى محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم.